Welcome back, everybody, here to the International 2016 European Qualifiers, game number two of our lower bracket first final between Escape and the boys, Fantastic Five. Can we double check my screen just in case? Because we did that little AF kind of thing before.
Yeah, it was just like, also we like look at the thing, we're like, wait, Team Spirit Illidan? We're like, wait, Spirit's not in this. What the hell is going on?
Yeah, and it just screws with the mind. And that's it. Like, that's something which I'm hoping Fantastic Five, like, they got over. That was terrific. Escape, that draft, like, it kind of, like, I hate saying it. I hate saying something like this, but saying when the draft is done, you're sitting there going, I believe this game is already done.
Yeah.
And then you have the first kill on top lane, you're like, now I'm confirming that this game is already done. Like, everything wasn't going to work in that game. How do you make this work now here in game two?
It was definitely a big struggle, but they just have to, you know, just don't let Fantastic Five get those comfort heroes. They gave them almost everything that we were talking about except for the Alchemist. We emphasized the Beastmaster. We emphasized the Wisp, and it's exactly what Fantastic Five took. This game, it's the same thing, though. They Fantastic Five gets Radiant, and Escape Gaming take Dire. I don't know if Escape Gaming chose, or if Fantastic Five.
Luckily, you have the chat log. You can go and look through it.
Do I have the chat log?
Yeah, you should be able to hit like little. Oh, the up arrow. You need to look at the lobby chat log.
How do I do that? I'm here. You can do this, man. Yeah. Oh yeah, like that. That's right.
You go.
Oh yeah, that's right. Yeah. Yeah, my brain.
Now you know what. Oh wait, hang on.
So Fantastic Five picked. 10 seconds. Okay, yeah. So Escape Gaming picked first pick, and Fantastic Five actually took Radiant.
They willingly chose Radiant.
That's a big change up from what people have been doing. It's pretty much role reversal. Usually, it's the team that picks first pick. The opposite team takes the Dire, especially because of the win rate here. So now Escape takes the Wisp for themselves. The bans are pretty much the same across the board. The Dazzle is a hero that is shared amongst both of these two teams. Like we were mentioning, Fantastic Five likes their healing support, their defensive support, while Escape Gaming, Cinder intends to really play Venge and Dazzle exclusively.
With ET and Beastmaster, I was waiting to see how Fantastic Five would react to the IO, and I'm wondering if this is Cinder also going back to what he believes is stable, and like it's that, you know what? We look at the Tiny, we look at the Wisp, we work with this together kind of style. Like, we just give Era what he's really comfortable with, which is always that IO-Tiny or IO-somebody combination. And then Fantastic Five, how do you react against this? Now, Disruptor has to be so high up in your list with a Timbersaw being picked as well. But you've got an Elder Titan. Like, it's a huge stomp area. It's a great ET splitter, which means Escape can't easily fight in a closed-up area. And you've got a Beastmaster who's already very good against a Timbersaw.
Yeah.
Once he gets that Blink and Necrobooks, which, as we saw in the last game, they were able to find space for. And you pick up the Timbersaw, now you're going to lose those combo heroes.
Yeah, you lose the combo heroes, but this is a hero that Escape Gaming's had much more success on. And I feel like they really want to emphasize on just getting Coif a hero that he feels super comfortable on and that they work around properly, because as we've seen in a couple of games now, the Invoker, when they don't have the proper draft, it seems to struggle quite heavily. The last time they actually picked the Wisp was that one game where they picked the Necrophos. They had that aggro tri-lane with Dazzle, Wisp, Necro, triple-ranged aggro tri-lane, and it worked out amazingly well for them. So I don't know if maybe they'll do something exactly the same this game, but it does put a little bit maybe a fear factor into Fantastic Five about dealing with that. But they do standard bans. They ban out the two very normal Wisp combos, which is the Tiny and the Sven. And Fantastic Five goes to the Disruptor, like you were mentioning, versus the Wisp.
They take out the cores over someone like a Disruptor who, like, for me, like during the later team fights as well, he's going to be so useful against a Timber. And you won't even need that much farm on him as long as you've got like that level 4 glimpse, the ability to wall and storm, then you've done your job for the team. You've got the Beastmaster control, Disruptor control, both are very good against the cores. And then you got the Elder Titan, which gives you such superior team fight. So then you think about how you couple all this together. You don't have someone like a Darksteer that makes it work, but you know you can at least make sure one hero was going to explode at every single fight with just these first three.
Yeah, and the first three for Fantastic Five have a nice variation of damage too. It's a mix between magical and physical, of course, between like the Beastmaster's aura and everything, Elder Titan amping up all those spells. But also, we've been mentioning it, the vision game. The team usually with the better initiation or the better vision tends to be more favorable.
Is this when you go the Night Stalker from Escape again? And you're like, hey, no stuns!
Right. I don't think we'll see that again this time, because actually I think Yapsor usually plays like that greedy for the Night Stalker type heroes for this team. And the Wisp.
Hey, no stuns! I remember this hero. There was words in Manila that were said about this. It's the drafting bait. You think it's really good, and then it's not. 10 seconds remaining. I love that look. That look is amazing, Fogged.
I actually just got really sad, to be honest. Like,
oh my god, I guess I'm gonna do so too.
They actually needed
something more, like a lion or like control with now drain against Medusa. That you pick up, unless this is like you run at a Timber mid and you run a core undying offlane. Is that one way you can salvage this? There has to be some kind of pocket. Like, this has to be some well thought out concept from Syndra. Either that or he's bet rares on this game for Fantastic Five.
Jesus Christ.
Hey, I'm allowed to rip Syndra.
I mean, I
maybe not that much, but I'm allowed to.
I kind of just like lost all my words for this because, like, I was mentioning how Fantastic Five, their first three heroes synergize so well. They have, like, of course, the Hawk and everything for Glimpse, the Astral Spirit for the Glimpse as well. A lot of different combos, multiple different forms of synergy between their heroes.
So explain the escape synergy.
And then the escape one is, I can understand, I guess, just because, like, the double heals on the Wisp, it's a really like heavy pressuring thing. And, all right, maybe we're going to be seeing it as an offlane Timbersaw, and they want to be able to force the experience him to be able to get that, or maybe they're setting up for an aggro escape run
Lone Jordan all three lanes.
Yes, they do.
So it's difficult to say exactly what lane's going to come up from this.
That's a good point. Yeah, Era is probably the least likely to be playing the Lone Druid, so more than likely it's the Kezu or Koipa.
Yeah, so I'd actually probably prefer the Koipa right now, and if this.
So maybe that's what they're doing. They might be setting up for an aggro Trident. Like, as soon as the other Titans pick, they realize, this hero's not strong.
You have to, right? You can't put an Undying in a safe lane.
Yeah.
Like, you're not going to run, like, a safe tri lane with Undying and Io. That makes no sense at all. It has to be an aggro tri lane, which means that Io is going to be coupling with someone who's a lot more aggressive, like a Gyrocopter, in the lane, and play that way. Put the Lone Druid in the mid and put the Timbersaw up on the top. Yeah, I cannot remember the last time they played a Gyrocopter. If that's what you're looking for.
I was looking to see just, at least for them, just because they played the Lone Druid earlier, but it's actually not showing up on Dota Buff, unfortunately. Oh, well. I thought that they had something else here, but either way. They pick up, the Lone Druid with the Undying. I mean, they like the Lone Druid a lot, but this Undying, man. It's funny. I had a small chat with Bruno about it in Manila, too, and we were like, cackling to ourselves. We're like, you play Undying, and you get into the laning phase, and you're like, holy shit, why is this hero not picked? I'm unkillable. I'm amazing. Then 2 minutes go by and you become super worthless. And that tends to be what happened. But it's a hero where you have to have a full idea of a big idea of like what you want to do with the game entirely. Mm. Because otherwise, he falls off very hard into the later portion of the game.
Go with me on this one. I actually think CK is the player right now for escape.
I like the CK.
They need someone that's able to kill, someone that's able to pull Fantastic Five out of the range of the tower. And work with the Undying in the early levels.
So they do ban the Necro. Ooh, Necro. That's Esco Escape was ran that other day.
Come on, what is this, an American team?
The thing about CK is, I can understand for the laning phase, as you're saying, but Fantastic Five's lineup in general, do they have, like, the most...
they're really good against it, but you need someone who's going to kill early on, and who are you going to couple with the Io? That's still the thing. Like, if you're going to run an aggro trial, if you're going to make the Undying work...
I'm thinking, Toby, okay?
You bring up your hero list, so you can actually look at it that way. Yeah, you need a hero list. Because this right now is just like, okay, Zeus is banned out. That's a good counter up against the Timbersaw on the IO escape. They found that one out early today when they played up against Alliance. Who fits the role?
I'm actually opening up the hero tabbies.
Who fits the role? Like... What are you gonna do? Pudget? Meat poet? I don't know.
I'm right there with you. I don't really know what heroes they have. I'm trying to think of era heroes. The Morphling comes to mind a bit, so Slardar.
Well, I suppose you get levels of aggression from this.
It's very like all in. Like, this is like a 30-minute lineup.
You can't get aggressive against an ET, though, can you? Like, you're going to get spirit stomped every single time you want to dive under the tower. The ET can sit back behind the T1 tower in the bottom lane and just put a spirit and stomp. You can't dive it. You can't attack it. That's something like they had to pull someone out of position. Because, like, the Slaughter's like, oh, like, someone has to come out of position. You have to rely on the safe lane of Fantastic Five to make a mistake, if that's what this is. If that isn't what this is, if this is actually like a Slaughter Undying safe dual lane, and then you run like a Timber Wisp off lane or dual lane mid and then a Lone Druid, Maybe that's the other way you can play this. You get early levels, but then you could hit a, like, hit a sweet timing. While Fantastic Five, I remember what happened with the Medusa. We saw what happened with Team Secret where they ignored the Medusa. And Medusa destroyed everything, and Sir Action Slacks is sleeping through this, but his hero is picked.
Is that a mid-Omni Knight?
That's a mid-Omni!
What is happening? What is actually going on?
It's Koifus Lone Druid, though. So it's going to be Lone Druid in the mid. It's an offlane Timber and a safe lane Slaughter, depending on how they switch the side lanes around.
So maybe they'll do just some dual lanes. Maybe this Undying pick is just to guarantee that Timbersaw can get XP in the offlane. Because like Elder Titan isn't really the strongest during the laning phase. Maybe that's what the kind of approach that they're trying to do.
Ooh.
I'm putting question marks at the end of every sentence.
Dude, there's really question marks. Yeah, question marks right now. You're like, how the hell is this meant to work? You've got a lineup from Fantastic Five, which actually synergizes beautifully, but you just wonder if the Omni Knight can perfectly work in lane. It may be the small window that Escape is looking for to get out of jail free. Because this draft seems very odd.
This is going to be a fun game.
Well, that's one way to look at it.
This is totally different.
That's like saying, hey, this date's going to be interesting.
This is totally different from what we've been seeing throughout these qualifiers, though. Like, completely different drafts and everything coming out from both teams.
Okay, so let's do this quickly.
Has there been any other Omni Knights? Any at all?
You're the man with the list.
I'm trying to think.
I have not seen one, but there's been so many games going on that it's possible.
We had 100 heroes picked out of the 100 and whatever, 114 or whatever it is. I don't know if Omni Knight was one of those. I wish that I had a stat man in my ear right now to let me know.
Yeah, you don't have a stat man.
I'm absolutely terrible at finding this.
Potentially you could have production in your ear if they're listening.
I'm sure in 5 minutes we'll have somebody be tweeting at us or something letting us know.
So something like that.
We'll update you with that very soon. But yeah, it's an Omni Knight pick. And it's Omni mid. It's a core Omni, which is a complete different change. And yeah, like you were saying, Slacks is probably like waking up in his sleep right now, cheering up and down.
We'll show him the replay later on so we can just be like, aww. Yep. All right, so first player to 15 denies.
Probably, what, Koikfa? It's Lone Druid mid, right, versus an Omni Knight.
Yeah, you'd think he should have the control there, but at the same time, he's been a little bit off.
Yeah, I mean, we can split up our decisions.
Okay, no, I'm actually going to go with Koikfa. I was tossing up between him as well as Illidan. Like, Illidan was the other one. Yeah, it's definitely Illidan.
Yeah.
For the second one.
The second one is... I put Illidan, like, instantly.
Team with the first barracks kill. I am actually going to back Fantastic Five. I love their lineup for this one. And the team with the first tower kill. That could actually go multiple ways. Wow, they're actually going to try and... Well, okay. Okay, killing this bear could be massive. They're body blocking it up.
Degen aura.
They are just trying to hold it here. You're right, it's actually a degen aura leveled up. They're going to wall it. You got another stomp in 1 second time. Cinderin, well, that's a nice decay to get. Gets a whole bunch of them. But then the stomp that puts Cinderin in a world of hurt. But he's got 880 HP. And then, in fact, the Illidan. Crush from Era. This is the way to do it. Illidan's going to drop his first blood. It goes the way of Escape Gaming. Okay, team with first tower kill, it can be Escape.
Yep.
And I'm not going to change any of the other predictions, but I just think because of this now, Koifa might be able to just team up and get that first tower kill, use the tombstone and take it out that way.
Yep, and as we were mentioning, like, you pretty much have to. You're in a position where you're locked into your lanes. Of course, they're going to go aggro tri-lane with the Wisp Undying and the Slardar.
Hey, isn't Cinderin just so powerful right now? Y'all, we'll push the wall up. Okay, Cinderin, not so powerful.
This
can't
set looks
walls.
Awesome, too.
Yeah, what is that? Like we've had the Bane Egyptian set. Oh, y'all as well.
Oh, he's
just keep
dead.
The decays going. They're gonna find even more kills. It's gonna be Era who will find this one. Aggro tri-lane. So far, finding two kills. And then they put a ward straight behind the tower. They wanna keep the pressure up. I'm wondering if this observe ward, which is already in the lane from F5, is able to like keep eyes on Cinder and realize he dropped the obs already.
I like this. This is a good approach, though. This is what they need to do with their draft, but they still just have to be careful. Don't overextend too much. Mm-hmm. Be sure to keep eyes on the supports of Fantastic Five so you know when you can be super aggressive and not.
Mm-hmm. This top lane should also be quite good for Keizu. Beastmaster is absolutely terrible against him. He can't harass him with balls because reactive armor is just reactive armor. So that's always an upside for him.
Yeah, you should be able to farm decently well, though. He did go for the Iron Town, though, on Pasha, so he really wasn't expecting to be in a 1v1 situation.
Y'all's going to realize soon that... Well, actually, he's already realized that camp's blocked up. But they're here to fight. They're not here to pull. Illidan will be able to give a small little advantage. And this is where I'm questioning if this lane can work. Like, once the ETS level 2, then I don't think Escape could find even more kills because it's just going to be Stomp into Mystic Snake. which is going to cause terrible amounts of damage.
They just they need to watch out not to get line up for those Mystic Snakes, because that spell, it may look like it doesn't do too much damage, but if you get the proper amount of jumps, it does one of the most damaged nukes in the game. Come.
They're chasing after Illidan, but it's baited Yol a little bit further. But Ira trapped inside the wall. Another good kinetic field up from the Disruptor. Not something you normally see leveled up early on from a Disruptor, but it's already saved lives multiple times.
Yep, and there's a kill, a solo kill by Kezu in the top lane on Pasha.
Okay.
He literally just walked up and whirling deathed him.
Timber is Timber. That's a good start to this game.
Yeah, very good start for Escape. They have the Timbersaw getting decent farm, Slardar's getting decent farm, and Lone Druid's getting very good farm.
Yeah, Absol is Invis sitting in the middle of the F5 heroes. He can't do anything with this. Not unless someone gets a little bit too close. But they have to move away from the tower for that. Alright, so this laning phase looks so much better for Escape, but I'm still worried about their synergy later on. Like, Timber is a fantastic hero, he's going to get a really good start, but he's still countered by multiple things on F5.
Yeah, absolutely. F5 does need to get their levels up, though. It is a bit greedy with the Medusa, Elder Titan, Disruptor, Trilane. All three of those heroes need levels, they need farm. Mm-hmm.
Medusa currently is only 6-for-1 up against the 14-6 of Ira.
Oh, they're diving. Ira,
yep.
Illidan's got two
decay stacks. There's your crush. It goes on Illidan. He's actually got the shields up for the moment, but the damage output is just too high from Escape. They keep going. They move over towards the Elder Titan. The second crush catching out both heroes. They move down to Yol. Yapson needs to switch this aggro over. He didn't do it in time, and he'll actually go down to the tower. The goal will be splitting Syndra, and also diving into the tower. The double TPs are coming. Syndra does not have a TP. Ira is trapped here, and Illidan, he wants blood. He wants kills. Put down a Spirit ET and give the vision. Find the heroes. The stomp way too early. Okay, will it be enough? They're only catching out Ira. Syndra's still hiding here, and Ira, where's the tree break? He can't. Okay, now he'll finally get through. He waited for the TP so we get a two-man crush. Still loses his life. And
did they forget about Syndra?
I don't know. The world's forgotten about Syndra. Back behind the tower. Yapsol maybe hasn't forgotten. Y'all's having a look around. But where's Syndra gonna go? He's got 5 HP. The spirit. Wait.
Oh, man.
It's like a wrecking ball!
I was going to say, they have to be a bit careful in how they dive, just because they have to make sure that the Slardar on the Undying Tank, because Wisp is one of those heroes, you have zero armor. So if the tower switches on you, you're extremely susceptible to dying, and that ends up happening. They trade a lot of kills there.
This Observer Ward finally coming down from F5, so they can see on the other side. They wanted to de-ward out the sentry that was inside the camp that was blocking the spawn. It actually ended up just timing out.
Yeah, but this is actually a pretty big problem for Pasha, because he started with that Iron Talon. He actually died a second time to Kezu solo in that offlane.
They're up a long way. Ira's in a good position for another double crush. They go with the Tombstone down, and RMN, where's the Stomp? It's already on cooldown. Now lets it rip. Will it be enough? Yapsaw just being punched down. So Yapsaw will die. Then Ira as well as Syndra cannot keep this chase going. In fact, you got Kinetic Field up in 1 second time. If Ira pushes this a little bit too far, they can go again. Spirit in the front line, the Stomp cannot connect.
Oh, he was dead if that caught him there.
So the bottom lane is becoming very
enjoyable? Yes.
Yeah, very enjoyable. as far as the other lanes go, if you're an Escape fan, they're more enjoyable for you.
Yes.
BZZ is definitely getting a lot of CS in this mid lane, but so is Koifa. So Koifa's progression is looking good. And Kezu is looking amazing. This Beastmaster is half of the CS of the Timbersaw.
He's about to get a bunch, though. He pulled the creep wave behind the tower. But Kezu did the smart play. He walks behind the tower, too, just to be able to contest the CS. And
is he going to keep going? Hey, he's got 15 up, right? Reactive armor charges up right now. He is so good.
Look at him go!
Yeah. Why worry? you're a Timbersaw against a lineup that doesn't have any really great stuns. Because the only people who have stuns are on the bottom lane, trying to keep that from just erupting into a full escape lane.
That was cute.
At least now they bring, I could say, BZZ rotates over. His purification is something which the Timbersaw should definitely keep in mind.
Yeah, it's a really interesting pick, though. I mean, it's a niche pick. It's something we haven't seen. I don't think we've even seen the Omni Knight, and then it's in a core position, which we absolutely have not seen.
Yeah. Well, BZZ was always known as that guy that would run unusual heroes in the core. He was the guy that ran the Jakira core for a very long time.
And his his famous BZZ Pugna set.
Yeah. Everyone. I own like five. Unwillingly.
Only?
Unwillingly. Well, I stopped buying chests a long time ago.
Yeah.
So I'm just like, this is such a waste of money.
Oh, I get it. These easy sets.
Wall, Cinderin, where's the vision? The Observer Ward up is already gone, so they can't glimpse back. And it's actually no glimpse. It's still a level 2 disruptor. Yep. It's actually got so low levels. RMN's managed to find 4 levels in this. But that disruptor just keeps dying too early on. Or just having to run away from the fights.
Yep, he's trying to do some pulls here, but it just keeps stacking, and they aren't able to actually clear any of the creeps there. It just ends up being a full denied wave every single time rather than some experience to be had.
Oh, BTZ actually hits so hard with that Omni Knight. With the Degen or into the Bear, sorry. And like, even if the Bear wants to try and pursue, he just purifications like that. Yep. And the Bear drops down lower, and then Koiva's like, I guess I'll just resummon then, huh? We're going again on bottom lane. Wall's going to catch out Era. Mystic Snake's already bounced through him. It's a good stomp. Yapsaw trying to keep him up. That glimpse is actually having no effect whatsoever as Yapsaw's tether will remain. They can turn around for the crush and RMN. Tombstone able to get beaten rid of by Illidan. And RMN, he's one hit away in Cinder and just wants to punch him. He'll have to turn for the decay, however. He's actually holding off on it so he can just punch him. A little bit further up, Illidan went for a long way up for the kill.
Yeah, Yapsaw had a bunch of stick charges saved up there from that fight, so he's able to burst heal Era up, and yeah, Keizu ends up taking out that top tower already, so he's extremely farmed with those Arcane Boots, Point Booster, and Soul Ring already finished up on him.
Keizu's coming down. Knocked down far enough. He has level 6, so potentially could have gone for the Chakram.
Still quite hard versus Omni-Knight with Repel, but yeah, he could have tried going for it. We do have Koiva finishing up his Midas, so his farm will be accelerated. Top lane, Keizu putting pressure on Pasha a bit more.
I'm interested to see like how much net worth Pasha can still get out of this lane. Like, he's sitting at 2.4k. That's really not that bad. And Keizu, like, he's got a lot of confidence to come down this far, and that's only because of reactive armor, and he knows that the two supports are stuck on bottom lane, and they cannot leave. But once Disruptor rotates up, then you have potential for kills. They just need a good timing for it, but Disruptor's coming straight back down to the bottom lane.
Yeah, now they have BZZ, he's in biz. This actually could be a huge opportunity for them, if they bait Illidan properly. They have to just make sure, though. They have to make sure to emphasize to break the Wisp, make sure he can't just freely bottle up his teammates.
They don't see him. They're not worried about a sentry ward in the lane when the Obs hasn't been dewarded.
Oh, Keizu makes his move now, too, though.
Okay.
They're giving Era the safe lane.
And they give Yol the mid.
They feel like they accomplished their job already.
Doesn't it feel weird like when Yol starts taking up the mid that you know F5 have switched the lanes up? There's something has changed. The Invis rune's about to wear off in a second. And they still haven't found an opening yet. The Dire Sentry is over on the side, so the only option that BZZ had was to walk straight up the lane. Sentry is actually going to go off now, but the Invis is also worn off. And BZZ, this is a lot of wasted time. It's like you've given him this farm, and then he's just ground to a halt. Said, now I am now fodder, and I will be utility mid.
Well, he is getting a chainmail too, so he's probably going
stomp.
Oh, they got the
gonna stomp hit on Keizu. They need to get in close, and that's where purified damage kicks in. But Keizu,
oh, Cinderin might die.
Very, very tanky. Oh, the Mystic. Mystic Snake. He had stick charges, Cinderin.
Yeah, two stick charges that he had there actually saved his life. It's very close.
All right. So we were right about the towers going the way of escape. Did you have that one as well?
Yeah, I put that one too.
Yeah. It's a Fantastic Five on the first barracks. And the reason why I'm actually still confident...
Top lane, Era. This might be the opportunity for them to get a kill on him.
Oh, he actually
gets
the
crush off before the roar.
Still there for Pasha. And with the boss there, they're not going to go anyway. Purification. Pasha, they could just protect him. And BZZ, he's such a tank. Yapsaw, like, you might want to help here, but they trigger the GA to run even harder. The ball is too far away from Yapsaw, and he can also tether away when the time is right, but forces the rotation out from Cinderin, leaving Keizu by himself on that bot lane now. Yeah. And that's just the easy synergy which comes from the F5 lineup. Doesn't take a lot.
Yeah, Omni-Knight heal is not something to ever really overlook, especially with a Slardar if you have Sprint on. You take like 400-something damage from the pure damage heal.
Koiva's ripping up the mid. He's already running the Midas. They got a hell of a lot of money on this lone druid. Sitting at 2.1k gold on the lone druid.
Yeah, that's actually pretty ridiculous, but it's expected.
But is Radiance Like, Radiance makes a lot of sense to get up against someone like a Beastmaster as well. But what else does he look for? Like, do you look for the lockdown? Do you just try and itemize against Medusa? And
just
then
standard.
What's the best against Medusa?
I think just the standard items. The Radiance and... Oh man, mid lane, this could actually be the potential to go on Koi'fa here.
Savage Roar makes this a little bit harder just to get the combo kidding. Off. And there's also no Storm. Yol does not have enough mana for this. And BZZ getting entangled. He's got 9-1 charges now. 10-1 charges up his sleeve. Is he going to trigger him to stay alive? When he's got extra health from Pasha, Roar is there. He'll actually go down. And he triggered the one charge, but it just wasn't enough. So it's an IO... for the price of the Omni Knight.
Yeah, they actually gain more out of it than Escape just because they're getting to be a bit behind.
And they burnt the level 1 Necro books too.
Yeah, two towers being killed already on the side of Fantastic Five. Era getting some nice farm in the top lane while Illidan does too. They're just a bit of a trade.
This lineup seems really, like, this matchup seems really easy for Illidan. Like, because he's just Mystic Snaking down Keizu all the time, so Keizu has no mana. Like, one charge is like the only thing, and his arcane boots is it.
And soaring, but
yeah, but like that's gonna give you enough to maybe escape, but you'll never have enough to be aggressive against Illidan.
Yeah, no way. I mean, the thing is that it's really
and now they're gonna go on him.
They have to commit a lot of heroes.
This time
this.
Actually has mana, so they start the glimpse, put him up in the wall storm, and Keizu purifications also here. They bring four heroes down to make sure that Keizu will die. Stone Gaze as well. Okay, that's some hatred. Keizu, he cannot survive this one if F5 want to make this worth it, but he's still 120 life. They need to finish the job. Purification not available. Now Yabzor tethers in. Keizu, the immortal Timber, will get relocated out. They don't find the kill. Ira's trying to scramble himself back behind the tower. They put up the wall and the dive. The wall didn't come up in time, so the dive will fail and Syndrome will rotate over. The tombstone very safely over on ESC's side of the river and bring in Keizu back to full life, back to full mana. No reactive armor charges up on him, but still it won't really matter. F5, they have to dive back past their tier 1 tower for safety. At least they won't have to deal with a tombstone, but they have to deal with a bear mauling up BZZ. Escape, they're finding more openings. Now going 10-6, and the Timbersaw survives and keeps his bloodstone charges.
Omni starting to fall behind a decent amount with those unfortunate failed rotations that he had two times now. And wow, though, like, how many ults was that? One, two ults?
Yeah, two.
Alright, so it's two ults for Timbersaw, but that's like all of their ults that they really have to expend on him. And he survives pretty much on his own. And then Yapzor, of course, with the beautiful relocate out the last couple moments, and then full heals him up, brings him back in, and the fight's completely gone into the favor of Escape Gaming. So lane's going very well for them, and it looks like it's just going to be that Roshan now soon with the amplified damage. Relic going to be finished up on the bear, and that's going to be Slardar's Blink Dagger. So they're hitting all their timings, and this looks like it could be a 1-1 coming up pretty soon for
it
Escape.
Could be. But at the same time, I thought exactly the same thing previously when F5 played their Medusa.
Okay.
And this is the one hero I think Escape need to make sure gets shut down. Yes, you're able to survive, but it's also the weakness. Okay, maybe we just watch F5 coming in. They need to get rid of the tombstone. Right, the wall comes up, gives them the vision on the high ground. Bear comes out, and Escape want to try and fight. Stone Gaze turns on from Illidan. The Soul Rib keeps the tombstone alive. They have to get rid of this zombie horde. If they don't do it, then... well, the fight will continue, and there we go. F5, Roshan still low. Escape of being scared out of the pit. They need an opening. There's a double stun. Pasha starts with a roar. Necro books are out. Yapzor just explodes, and they glimpse Syndrome into this fight too. Necro units are still alive, and Escape. Well, you thought they had a great fight on bottom lane. Now the Storm comes in. Ira can't find himself a good crush, but he's between the heroes. The Storm, it keeps Keizu under control too. They are basically playing around the Timbersaw. No one let him be involved until now. Illidan may be forced to do it, but with the Mystic Snake, they burn through the mana. These Necro units have stayed alive almost this entire time. The Sharkan reveals he's up on the hill. They'll glimpse him back down again, and they're going to try and find the kill, the purification, but the relocate out. Once again, Yamsor is there for his teammate. Mystic Snake, all you want. This will stop F5 from taking Roshan, and Koi'fa distracts them by just pushing down the mid lane, trying to get F5 to move away from the pit.
And they just had to run. They can't kill this Timbersaw. Like, he's just kind of just waving between the fight. They don't have that much lockdown to really just keep him in place, but besides like the silences and the Elder Titan Stomp, the Roar always gets used on the Wisp, and yeah, Yapzor just buys back and is able to relocate Keizu. And now once the Radiance is going to be finished up in a second on Koi'fa, there's going to be so much just little bit of damage just ticking out constantly onto Fnatic 5's, or Fnatic, Fantastic 5's lineup.
up against the former member of Fnatic. That would have been hilarious if that's what they're called. Right. But Roshad now going to go down. So Aegis Immortal gets put into the hands of Era, allowing him to be very, very aggressive with that Blink Dagger and look for a target. It's RMN. Chakram is available. They need that Blink into Crush, and they're going to get it. What a great time to also get that Blink. Yep. This now means the ET is down. And they've got a lot of good pushing power.
Yeah, they've got their item timings like pretty much perfectly right now, all synergizing for escape. They've got the Bloodstone finished a couple minutes ago for Kezu. Era, like you mentioned, the Blink Dagger. Radiance coming out for Koifa very soon. And how's Sin doing? Okay, Syndra and the Whisper, not really farming the best in this game. But
Syndra's at 2.5k net worth.
Yeah, the cores are what matters, though, for this one.
Oh, yeah.
At least for
I still wonder how they take high ground once the Medusa starts getting bigger. Like, even at this stage of the game, you've got Mystic Snake and you've got ET Spirit. That should be enough to hold out Escape from taking racks for a good 40 minutes.
Definitely. The only real way for them to go is after a team fight. They have to get some pickoffs into a tower push, because pushing into Elder Titan and Medusa is not realistic.
Yep. And you see Illidan's build as well. Like, he's going as defensive as he possibly can. Picking up the Lincoln Sphere as his next major item.
Lincoln's? What the hell?
Is it Lincoln's? Yeah, it's Lincoln's.
No,
right?
I know, but I'm just like, there's only one thing that he blocks, and it's amplified damage, which has a 5-second cooldown.
Unless he's thinking about something else, but what else do you got? You got... I haven't seen a Battle Fury Medusa since, like, 8 years ago. 8 years ago. It was in Warcraft 3 Dota. It was actually a legit thing back then.
So, yeah, okay. Blocks Soul Rip, and amplified damage. That's it.
Yeah, that's not so great.
But blocking amp can be good. Those 5 seconds of having your armor not be completely deteriorated is...
It's not bad, but you could also just build up into something like Ascardi, and then you've got so much more life, you'll be able to survive it anyway. Timbersaw, gonna have a crack at Illidan. Illidan just raises the shields. Relocate comes in. They need a stun, and they do it. They bring in the slot of the man with a crush. And you can say goodbye to Medusa.
Yep. Pasha finds an opportunity on Koifa, gets the roar out. Savage roar off.
They need to get a revenge kill right now. The tombstone is still down. The splitter snapping back Koifa. With Sharkum arriving, Pasha just disintegrated. The bear is still in the middle of this fight in the storm, so he will go down. There's a resummon available for Koifa. Can he actually get the bash onto 633? No, he can't. PZZ will be able to escape. And RMN also on the retreat. Stomp ready, puts down the spirit, tries to create some space, unable to do so, as now sent back up into the higher ground. Era locked in pretty low. Is there a glimpse? Yep! You're going to drag him back, but Yabzor is still tethered to him as Era just goes ham up into the high ground, unable to find anybody with that blind crush. But now with the amplification on RMN, maybe he wants to go in again. 3 seconds until that blinks back off cooldown. Keizu still on the front lines. Heavy Bloodstone charges plus the reactive armor charges are up. So if they want to fight this one, ESC, they could potentially do it. They turn around. Yabzor, do you want to have a crack? Not with Stone Gates. It's all about run away, and then you can re-engage once that's gone, because Illidan's mana is almost nothing. But they say, let's not risk it. Even with the Aegis Immortal, we don't have to give F5 anything.
Yeah, and they don't, like you mentioned, they don't want to give F5 anything. They got a good amount of damage on the tower, just a bit, and they just won a big team fight and took a tower already and got an aggressive ward up. So their objectives that they gained were already done in that position.
You did use a buyback a couple of minutes ago from the IO. That's like the only downside of ESC's recent fights.
Yeah, but that buyback also saved Kezu. So downside, but at the same time, not a downside.
Worth it. A sacrifice worth it.
Yeah. Pasha with book 3, like we saw before. Illidan not doing so hot though.
No rune for Era. BZZ will steal the regen. Reveals the fact they do have like the Observer Ward down.
How well is this? The thing for me also is like, how well is this single core Medusa? He does have a Beastmaster, of course, who amps him up quite a lot, and the other Titan Aura, but how well is this single core Medusa going to be able to deal with a Lone Druid who is free farming, a Timbersaw who is free farming, and a Slardar who is kind of free farming?
All y'all wanted to do was remove a ward. They relocate in for him. He tried to actually throw down the storm and predict the exact spot of Yapzor and Era's movements, but it just didn't have its effect fast enough.
Yep, and now there's no Disruptor ult, so this is a window for Escape to actually build a... take the tier 2 quite easily, but there's still going to be the ET and the Medusa spam.
Okay, you ever watch, it was a strat in Southeast Asia for a while, and it had Naga Siren, Obviously, Miracle was the one who was doing it. Nagasarin as well as ET together. And just with those two, they could keep the creep wave back at the mid lane.
Oh, yeah.
And they never even left the base to do it.
I love ET Naga just in general. Like,
oh, okay.
All right.
That's some hatred. Take what you can get. The Necro units actually help him get out the observable that was planted down by Escape too. So, hey.
Yeah.
That's worth it.
ET Naga is super fun, though. You get into the sleep into Earth Splitter as well, which is a really cool combo.
Get an armlet now over on Era, so a little bit more strength coming his way. How's Koifa going for his build? It's the AC.
AC, yes. I like the armlet pickup for Era, just being another core. You know, he's not locking himself into like being a support, like a three, basically. Now he's pretty much going to keep himself up as a two.
Still feels a little odd with like Syndarin. Like, the longer this game goes on, the less useful this Undying is going to be.
He becomes less useful, but at the same time, like, oh, another relocate on Yule. Ah. He's like, please, no.
Again, all he wants to do is deward. He's not asking the world. He's got his job to do as a support hero.
The one thing that Undying can do in these fights, though, is that if he's sitting really far back, he has Soul Rip every 6 seconds.
Oh, the blink. The crush catches Illidan. BZZ's going to be there. Repels on Illidan. And Illidan will just try and turn to a little bit of chip damage. Mystic Snake.
Bounces to the courier.
Yeah, but does no damage. Didn't realize it would actually bounce to the target.
I didn't think it would bounce there either. That actually looked super funny.
Still does no damage, obviously, but that's not the point.
It looked cool.
But here's that split push again happening from F5. And Escape, like, this is one of these things where F5... I've seen them do this multiple times in the tournament, but they just make better decisions on the side lanes. Like, it looks like everything's out of control. Like, Escape are now 10k advantage in front for gold. About 8k in the experience. This lone druid is getting bigger and bigger. The assault cuirass is getting better and better. But they just seem to be finding the farm to get their cores up to where they need to be.
Yeah. We were mentioning just how they need to, like, take fights outside of the base and then make sure they get a bunch of kills, and that's how they take objectives, because breaking into the ET and everything is very difficult, but...
Smoke maneuver, they need knobs.
They have a lot of healing on the side of Escape with the Soul Rip and the mech soon coming out.
Syndarin's hung around here long enough, they could potentially glimpse him into a fight. But then you do this big smoke maneuver for absolutely nothing. With the sentry down too, they understand they're not being visible. But the fact they're also not being visible on any lanes apart from Illidan attacking into the mid-tier 1 is going to flag it for ESC. That's why they're pushing in the top lane.
Yep, and Illidan is getting close to that Lincolns that we were talking about. But, yeah, they don't want to lose their last tier 2. They want to at least try to defend it, it looks like. They're sending all 5 heroes. And it looks like BZZ is actually going back for a Midas, so they're going for this late game. He's got his Arcane Boots mech on the Omni Knight, and then, yeah, he's got the Midas recipe in base.
Mystic Snake and Split Shot with Purify. Say goodbye to your creep wave. Keizu wants to burn a little bit of the mana off Illidan to start with. But Mystic Snake is such a beautiful thing that Illidan's going to get it back the second ESC try and force this. And what have we got flying out in the courier? So he brings the Lincoln's recipe in, so.
The Lincoln's and the Midas. Or did he not put the Midas on the courier? No, he did put the Midas on the courier. He just didn't pick it up. Oh well. Okay, this was actually quite low.
Yeah,
but there's the Soul Rip. That's the one nice thing, is especially too with the tether. Tether into Soul Rip, it's actually a huge amount of healing. It's 480 and then doubled. Or 1.5 times as much, so.
Oh, they're beating through Koifa's bear. Koifa's got to resummon. He knows he can just force the issue. Because he's a lone druid. Flims back and take Keizu out of this one. The Yule Scepter goes up and towards the air. As the Roar Splitter over on the side. Era gets far enough away and then turns on that arm at the right time. But Stonegaze Illidan gets in front. Era's going to go down. So they turn on the Guardian Angel. Looking for that extra saving grace. As they bring down the Tombstone and look for more kills. Keizu's on the run.
Yapzor's relocate was off the mark too. They're pinging him out. And they look like they're going to go for the kill here on him.
Do they have enough? Yapzor, he's got a tether target. Tethered the lone druid bear came in. And he looks like he's going to be able to walk himself off this one. Unless someone can blink forward. But then again, you can blink with the Beastmaster, but there's no Roar, there's no Boars.
And he survives. Wow. They only end up losing 2 heroes, so... Amazing fight.
You lose the tier 1 tower as well, though.
Yeah. Amazing gonna be quick enough for Fantastic Five.
But this is it. Like, this is what I was talking about. Like, you get enough on Fantastic Five that they can just... They're strong enough to fight.
Yeah.
You get the Blink level 3 Necrobooks over on Pasha. This now means, like, wait, we go back to what we said during the draft. You're deleting one player of ESC from the fight at the very, very start. Right now, all they want to do is delete a bear, but they can't keep the damage on him long enough, so they can get recalled back over to Koipa.
Yeah, and they almost killed Kezu there as well. He was extremely low. The thing is with Kezu, in these fights, they have to just recognize if they do kill Kezu, he's going to be back in the fight within like 5-10 seconds. He's got 18 Bloodstone charges, pretty much an instant respawn.
That Radiant Observer was watching Kezu moving around, and it's also going to flag the fact that F5, I need to get over the Roshan pip.
Can't contest Dire Slardar Roshan.
You do have the ET though. That's probably the only advantage you do have, but you need to be in position before Roshan starts for that to work.
Kezu finishes up his Aghanim Sector, so he's going to be dishing out so much damage, especially with the Yule Scepter for more sustainability and more like setup. He can put the double chakram under the Yules and just burst pretty much anyone on the side of Fantastic Five down. And yeah, he is definitely a problem for them. They are very unable to kill him, especially even earlier in the stages of the game. They couldn't kill him, and now it's just becoming a little bit easier, but still, like I was mentioning, it's got high Bloodstone charges, and they have to remember that.
It's also because, like you look at the physical damage output from Fantastic Five. Where does it really come from?
It's literally only the Medusa. That's
But it's also because, like, the Medusa builds a Lincoln Sphere.
Yep.
Like, her first major item is a Lincoln Sphere. You've got no damage coming out. So as long as, like, and maybe that's the mindset and that Illidan has of this game. It's like, as long as I survive the early stages, no surprise jumps. Oh, wait, the surprise jumps that do hit me is Blink Crush. Blink doesn't block it. But it's still decent stats and regeneration. Maybe it's just this basic thing he has to go towards. If he gets then the Mantar up and running, does that then give him enough where he feels like he can break free from a lot of attacks, he could dodge a lot, he can, with the illusions, like, push back ESC and buy time for himself as well as the rest of his team, and then they play around like each other and the trust of each other. Like, the Guardian Angel still can cause real problems for escape if they overcommit. That Guardian Angel's gonna wreck them, and then you've got the massive problem of I've overcommitted against a disruptor.
Yep.
I can't bail out of this situation, so I'm gonna get dragged back in, and all of a sudden you're losing 1-2 heroes. The push stops and everything starts to grind to a halt.
As long as Yol is in better position, though.
Yes.
He's actually been caught out of position so many times in this series, not just this game, but in the game previously before too. His position is kind of just looking a bit weird to me. Like, even the series before when they were playing, he was playing like the Earth Spirit and stuff, and he had the Earth Spirit game, and then he had the Venge game, and there was just multiple times where he's just either running around doing his own thing, or he's just literally just out of position in the engagement. Especially like this, it's been like 3 times in the past few team fights, he's been forced to use Glimpse in a completely defensive manner because he's getting gone on because he's not playing in the back line. But I'd like to see Illidan at least pick up just the ulti orb and make the decision, either go for that Manta like you're talking about, or just make the decision, it's like, all right, this Manta's really not going to do as much as I think it is, and just maybe even just go for that Ayaskadi that we do see some people like, and especially, you know, Black. Black hates Manta on Medusa. He says it's super situational, and I actually have to agree with him.
Hey, if there was, like, VSs and projectile stunts coming his way, then I would probably back Illidan to get the Manta as well.
Yeah.
Like, the only reason why I see it be viable in this is just because of the illusion deep push.
Yeah, and he has, like, even though he's lacking some damage and stuff, he has the Elder Titan aura, which is always going to boost that up, and the Beastmaster aura, which helps a lot.
Yeah. So he can bide his time for now. But the Scardy up against 3 melee cores, even though Timber Chain is obviously a great ability for a Timber Sword to use, once Beastmaster has done his work and he's able to, like, burn off the mana of the Timber Sword with a Necrobook blink in, then you're good. Like, and if he doesn't go for that, I'm wondering if his other primary target is just going to be the Io. Because the Io, you're probably going to have a better chance to kill Blink, Raw, Necros. The Io should be dead by the time that the Raw wears off.
Yeah, that's pretty much what they need to Blink, Roar, like, either one of them, probably. If like, the Slardar is in a super bad position, then, of course, they can Roar him and burst him down. But other than that, you probably want to get the Wisp. It's, like, Wisp priority, then Undying priority, then it's, depending on positioning, it's, like, the Slardar priority and everything else for the Roar. But also, I didn't really point it out, just because I kind of, like, overlooked it. We don't really see much Omni Knights, but the Lincoln Sphere synergize is really cool with the Repel. But that's just, it's not really going to do too much for the side of it versus Escape Game, because none of them really build Diffusal, so it's not a problem.
Yeah. Get items which don't make perfect sense. K2, though, his items make perfect sense.
Yep, level 7. He's already got his level 16 double chakram.
That's the only thing which is a little bit different in this build, as opposed to getting something more like a like an early Shiva's or something along those lines. But he goes into the Ags after the Yules and the Bloodstone. It's not that uncommon, just a small variation from the builds I've been seeing so far in the qualifier.
Man, and I got nobody updated with saying if the Omnidot was picked or not. Nobody said anything. I checked a few times. Nobody tweeted anything.
God, BTS production value.
Not even just BTS, like anybody could have sent, anybody, any of you could have sent us a message. Is this the first Omninet game?
Hey, you know what, I actually asked this because I don't know if people knew, but Red was having information fed to him by Knoxville at the Major. Sorry, I broke the illusion now. They actually want that kind of information fed over to the co-casters.
Yeah, you know.
During games as well.
I know.
So you have Knox passing little pieces of information, or whoever's doing the stats, pass it over during the games. It's just like you do it like in baseball. It's like, and so John Smith has managed to have 3 outs on the 9th inning, or something like that. It's in his games in 2016, first quarter.
And I'm wrong.
You're wrong? That was the game?
IG Vitality picked Omni Knight 8 hours ago versus Vici Gaming Reborn. Okay, I had to do it myself. Nobody did.
Your life is so hard.
Making me
Would you like to control a camera?
What? I'm controlling my camera. It's really nice. I like having my own. I can look at really cool stuff like these things that are going on in the trees while you're looking at all this important stuff.
Yeah, you don't have anyone that actually freaking judges your camera work, so you're fine. Hey, you said they wouldn't build a diffuser blade. They built a diffuser blade.
Well, who's got it?
It's on the Lone Druid Bear.
He actually did build one.
He built a diffuser blade.
Okay, all right.
Lincoln's Spear now makes sense,
Lincoln's,
right?
Lincoln's and
Oh, wait, they're relocating down? Goodbye, Beastmaster. You don't get mopped up. That's 1 minute without the Beast, 1 minute without that jump initiation. But the mid lane as well as the top lane is still in favor of F5 for now. And you've got the two D pushers up. Illidan's coming back for the defense. He's also walking around with the Demon Edge. It was the Rapier that brought Team Secret down last time. I don't know if it'll be that this time around, especially considering there's a Radiance. More than likely, it's just going to be a standard Monkey King bar.
Yeah, maybe but it is. It might be the Rapier.
It's an MKB.
It's an MKB.
MKB. Like, if it's anything other than an MKB, I will not eat my shots. But
he might just feel super far behind. They are 12k behind already, but maybe they feel a lot of pressure, man.
I think he's burning that Mystic Snake really early. Like, I thought he'd actually wait for the creep wave to at least come in before he did it. Now it's on cooldown for a little bit longer. It allows ESC to come to the high ground without taking heavy amounts of damage. As, the tether keeping the bear alive. Actually, Yabsor instantly cancelled that one. And now it's the bear. Era jumps in.
Off the rappel.
And well, BZZ, he's going to go down. He thought he was safe to disrupt the storm with the ET splitter. It hits Keizu and breaks the Aegis Immortal with a roar out too. They're trying to burn down the manor of Keizu. They have to relocate him back just a little bit, not too far, but it's out of peril of F5s. So then he can reinitiate back in again with a blink crush from Era, catching Pasha and RMN. ESC inside the base of F5, maybe a little bit against their will. Illidan still trying to pump out damage, but he doesn't have that much. The Rax is going to go down in favor of ESC to start with. So welcome to one prediction as Keizu tethers himself away in a little bit too deep. You have the level 4 glimpse, and who are they bringing back? It's going to be Era, but he's got a Blink Dagger of Vumble and no wall to hold him in.
They have no damage.
Yeah, this is the Lincoln's issue.
It's too much sustain on the side of Escape too. They have the Soul Rip with the Mac, with the Arcane Boots, with the Tether, of course, from the Wisp, and also right away, the Diffusal Blade pays off. They get the Diffusal on the Repel on the Omni Knight and burst him down. So that bottom racks, like we were mentioning, they usually want to get a pick before they are able to transition into a full high ground thing. They pick off the Beastmaster, then they kill the Omni Knight directly right afterwards. But still, it looked like they could have actually just slow siege that one without even actually having to pick anyone off with the advantage that they have.
And I get so concerned about this, but it's still like ESC, they take the first racks. Fantastic for them. This is going to push Coit for even further up. The man who hasn't died yet, he's over 20k in the net worth. Overall, ESC are just so far ahead. But you never want to underestimate a Dusa.
Yeah, definitely not.
And I keep coming back to the point, so I feel like I'm a broken record. But at the same time, like...
Yeah, you don't want
to... Once the damage arrives, ESC have to give it respect. And then just do the slow siege.
Yeah.
So they just play it smart.
I think it's
not gonna. It's still under Radiance.
He might feel obligated.
He might feel obligated, but he also needs to direct attack and not have the Radiance screw him up all the time.
Yeah, maybe
Escape doesn't see it coming and they make some over aggressive move, it could be the game changer. But they are, like you were saying, quite far behind already, looking at a 20,000 gold advantage for Escape Gaming.
Well, Illidan, do you feel actually, yes, hello. You are right. It's a rapier.
He needs it. He wants it.
He's actually getting the rapier. He'll come out and farm up this wave. The courier is going to do the dirty work, but might be better if he uses his own hero. The Obs and Sentry will be scouting the movement out. The courier's coming in too. He's 5 gold short, so he can't get it straight away. So he's here a little bit before his time, but then Era jumps him. The BKB protection. Does he actually want to buy it now? He's next to the shop. He could fight it, and yep, buys it mid-fight. Needs this damage. Syndra might go down pretty damn quickly. We'll stick with Illidan. They bring down the tombstone. Yapsol's here. Syndra is dropping quickly. They're keeping the split shot working, and Illidan, it's a double kill for him. The brand's fresh, spanking new rapier going to work. Meanwhile, over on the side, Keizu, he's trying to chase after Yol. The repel's over on him, that won't stop Keizu from finding the kill. Timbersaw will find that one, but now Illidan makes his way down. Guardian Angel gonna be triggered. Keizu should be able to tank through this one. They get through the creep wave as Keizu brings down a triple kill on the Omni Knight. Pasha and Illidan both need to retreat. They need to keep the rapier secret. They need to keep it safe. Maybe not so secret, but down on bottom lane, that's also being pushed in. Defense time.
All their lanes are pushing in heavily, and Escape Gaming, every time the fights are being taken, it's on the enemy side of the map, so they're actually able to gain something out of it, while Fantastic Five is pretty much all defensive. Small victory for them there, but still not really enough.
It's the fact that it shows that you have still not enough damage from Illidan to take care of the Timbersaw.
Yep.
It also does, however, show that the supports will just crumble underneath that Medusa. The Io and the Undying cannot stay close.
No, yeah, they can't stay close at all. But they did place down some nice aggressive wards on the side of Escape Gaming. Now they're able to see the small movements that are coming out from Fantastic Five. And it looks like we'll probably see them wait for that next Roshan, and then that's when they'll go for their siege.
Mm-hmm. Makes a lot of sense. Octarine's on the way now for Keizu as he picks up the Soul Booster.
He's so farmed.
Yeah, he really is. He actually now has the top net worth on the field, more than the Lone Druid, who's still sitting on 3.6k gold. And that's going to be Lone Druid picking up. Well, he could actually go Daedalus or MKB, either one. Probably going to be the MKB just for the extra control. And yeah, that's exactly what it is.
MKB for, yeah. Butterfly is a natural build-up for Medusa, so no shocker for him to pick that up.
I'm wondering, though, if Illidan even goes for that. Like, he kind of needs, like, strength and ability to kite. He actually needs the Scotty still.
Or another rapier.
Or another rapier.
Yeah, MKB,
or maybe the Monkey King bar for direct attack. So he comes up. Sells it. It's gonna. He's got an ultimate orb, so either he finishes the Manta, or he'll eventually progress into the Scotty.
I think he'll go for the Scotty. No. He's gonna buy the Manta right now. As soon as I say it.
You're still up against 4 melee heroes and a melee pet.
Yeah.
Like Scotty just looks so, like on paper, the best thing.
Yep.
Oh my god! I become the Huzz.
On paper. Oh no.
On paper, this hero looks absolutely fantastic. In 80% of the games he's played this time around, he has won in the TI qualifiers.
All right, Alan sounds way cooler than that, man.
Yeah, he really does. I don't know why I just went into that old school radio voice. It just seemed good at the time.
Kez's performance this game, though, is quite stellar. Getting up those, you know, the multiple individual solo kills onto the Beastmaster. Of course, because Pasha went for those jungling items right away, because he didn't expect the laning setup. But still, yeah, Keizu has got 0 deaths, and he's about to be 6 slotted already in this game.
Quick Roshan.
And it's up.
Here they come.
Cheese Aegis.
At least Illidan. Manta scouts. Like, they can see Illidan running off on this bottom lane.
So he did go for Manta. Okay.
Yeah, he did. He finished it. Right, he has to create some kind of chaos in the fights. But I think that's also one of the other things for him. Like, if he's got the Manta, then ESC, it's not going to be as straightforward.
Yep, removes the Amplified damage as well and gets the root off.
He should actually never be Amplified in a fight then, with both Lincolns as well as that. Maybe it's actually worthwhile just putting the Lincolns on the Omni Knight if they want to put him on the front row.
Yeah, he already had the Yasha there in that slot anyway, so maybe he just felt like, alright, whatever. I just got to have my TP and have my killer still. I don't want to be selling any items.
Okay, Illidan must buy a Monkey King part next.
Yep.
Like, you've now got a Solar Crest over on Slaughter.
I like that pickup a lot. We've been seeing people going back for the Solar Crest lately. Even Envy. Envy's been doing it on the Death Prophet a lot, which is really cool and very out of the box.
They're trying to pump so much money into this Dusa. Roshan, they're hovering around it. There's Obs and Sentries everywhere for the Radiant side. No Hawk should come out. At the same time, they have to keep slipping a hero down. Illidan's easy enough to do it. Down to bottom lane to keep that pushed out. But the top lane's also on its way to the tier 3 tower. It won't do any real damage unless someone wants to TP up there. And that's something which someone like a Timbersaw is able to do. Like, TP up to the lane. You know your bottom lane's always going to be pushed out. And you've got a tier 1 tower on bottom lane anyway. Like, that thing's still up and running 38 minutes into the game.
Yeah, that's a big problem. And it looks like Fantastic Five actually, they want to try to contest for this.
Yeah, they actually saw the Astral Spirit up on the top lane and then drew a direct line saying, yo guys, F5 is on this hill. So the Spirit will come in, he'll have a look inside the pit, the Mystic Snake will bounce, actually triggers the block of the off Roshan with the Crush as well. Keizu will be slowed up for a little bit. Illidan, he wants to come forward. The problem is, he cannot lose this Rapier. So starts the Stonegaze, looks to snatch out the Aegis the Immortal, and he's actually, well, the kill goes to the Dire side, so Medusa will snatch the Aegis the Immortal, now looking to pump the damage in to that armlet turned on Era, but the fight's still splitting up with that, actually, have they got enough damage? With the split shot, Cinderin's dropping down low, the ET split will happen, they bring down the Bear, Coif will have to resummon this one, but Era back in for the two-man crush with the double Chakrams, they're burning through Illidan, BZZ has to repel and move himself away from this one, while Illidan just trying to be tower defense at the moment. Cinderin's being chased down by Pass from the back lines. Yapzor's going to help him out, but Illidan focusing the damage. Cinderin inside the pit using the Fog of War to survive, and they don't know exactly who they're trying to kill off here. With the split shot from Illidan, he just wants everyone but can't claim one. They are just splitting up this entire fight. He might get the secondary bear, but now he's actually going to lose a rapier, and with that, he should be losing the game. The Aegis Immortal will give him more time. Relocates on the way. BZZ makes his way forward. He needs to make this perfect timing to save up Illidan, who wants to continue to battle against the rest of ESC. Push him up the hill, get him up to safety, make it so Keizu has to keep working hard for this one. The Yule's up from Keizu, keeps fighting up against Illidan, and maybe now he'll start to back off as mana drops down low. ESC are still on the run. Illidan to the front lines. Find Cinder. It's amazing what happens when he focuses his damage. Pasha gets the vision, needs the roar to actually find any kind of kill here. But Cinderin just outruns him. He's actually got better movement speed at the moment. Back to the tier 3 tower.
Breathe, Toby, breathe.
It's fine. Not required.
Non-stop.
They have to come back. They have to come. Look at that bottom lane. They're going to lose tier 4s. They're actually going to lose their buildings. They're going to lose their buffer from ESC just slipping through the back lines.
Yeah, still though. That's the... We were mentioning how the Aegis and Cheese is the window for escape. Even though they are, you know, 30,000 gold ahead, that's the... It makes the ease of execution to go up on that high ground.
How much damage can the illusion... Not enough. I'm like, can they actually kill off this tower by themselves?
Yeah, unfortunately, illusions do not benefit from plus damage, only from stat damage.
Uh-huh.
So that is not a tower that he will get. But
Illidan did still live through all of that.
Yes.
So he's now got the next ultimate orb.
Like two buybacks, though. It was the Beastmaster and the Omni Knight that were forced to buy back in that engagement.
That's a little bit more expensive. But in this situation, it's 4 protect 1.
Yes.
Like, you will lay your lives on the line. Beastmaster got everything he needs, aka Blink Raw Necros. Like, that's all he really needs. Omni Knight, like, he's doing his job. He would prefer to have probably the Greaves up and running, something along those lines, a little bit more cheaper, but, like, having 4 staff mech as well as the rest of his heals, that just is enough as well for him.
Look at this. Do you see this Elder Titan abuse?
What?
So, when his spirit's getting pulled back, he's spamming and canceling Echo Stomp, so instead of the spirit flying back super fast, it stops over and over and over and over, so he's able to position himself to get extra damage and stomps. Actually a cool little trick. Haven't seen too many people goof around with that.
Well, Iron Man will take anything he can get, including levels. This guy is still level 12. Is he actually the lowest? Nope, Disruptor is the lowest at level 9. Yol is 0 for 7 in this game.
Yeah, he's struggling quite a bit in, like I was mentioning, in this series, in this game, and in the previous series beforehand.
Illidan needs more money. The only way to find that though is coming outside the base, because they're managing to be so good with pushing out the lanes now that ESC are in a better position to try and fight them away from the F5 base. It's also because it's an instant respawn for a Timbersaw with 29 Bloodstone charges, so this is always going to be a 6-on-5.
Yep. He's completely six-slotted for the past couple minutes.
Mm-hmm. There's nowhere else for him to go now. Yeah. Like, I don't think you even want to drop the Shivas in this game.
Eventually, maybe get rid of some the Yules with Dagon 5 or something. Because you're unkillable anyway, right?
That'll work. The Yule seems to be a nice little thing that allows him to buy time, though, when he's being attacked.
Yep.
So it's actually making it so that F5 spent a lot of their time just trying to chase him. Okay, glimpse. Wall. There's going to be no ulti committed, so they don't want to put the storm up. Obviously, they know the wall's not going to hold the Timbersaw. Not while he's got chain, but this is a smoke maneuver from ESC. They need an observer ward inside the base. The creep wave vision isn't enough. All they see right now is Illidan inside the base. And with these continuous spirits, okay. He started the stomp as Koifu was TPing up to the top lane. But it was just a little bit too late.
Yeah, and they're... Like we've been saying, it's kind of hard to break into that high ground without a pickoff.
God, look at this advantage. You'd think this would be easier for ESC when you're over 32k in front. Life just seems to be really hard. And now the Skadi is done over on the Medusa.
It is their last life, you know, on the line, so they're going to take this as carefully as possible, make sure that they don't make any silly mistakes and win, because they...
Very true.
They did make silly mistakes in the previous...
This is elimination. Like, you get all the way through. They had a playoff for the direct invite as well, which they ended up losing to Team Secret with. So that wasn't the greatest thing. It's actually kind of funny that we actually have the two... Like, the other two teams were playing for the first slot. Now in this matchup.
But he does need that MKB up, as you were mentioning it. Pretty soon.
The Skadi had priority, though. He could sell off the Ring of Aquila in a bit. And then the last thing will just be his BTs. And that'll be primarily for split push into fight. A full Mjolnir. Now bought up as well for Koifa. That bear is actually quite brutal. With farming and fighting.
Yeah, it really is. I would really like to see them pick up like more defensive items to the...
You're worried the bear's
for the Medusa.
Oh, with Medusa?
Yeah, with Medusa. Just like...
You don't think that she has to go full damage and use her teammates as human shields?
She has to go full damage. Her teammates need to build more stuff. Like, you can see RMN built the Solar Crest. He built the drum. He's building little items to just give a bit of a boost to Illidan. So they need to just keep doing things like that. Like, we were mentioning the blink or the Force Staff on... BZZ.
Is it worth one getting one over on Yol, or is it better for Yol to get something like a Blink Dagger so he's got better positioning in the fights?
Hey, I don't think he's ever going to get an item. He's he's the hard sack 6, unless they get like a huge teamfight engagement where he survives. I'm trying to think what items, though, because Lotus Orb doesn't really benefit them at all.
Yeah, especially when you've already got the Linked Sphere up, which blocks like 2 abilities.
Yeah.
Oh, you called it. There's your Dagon now coming in for Keizu.
Yep, so sells the Yules, picks up Dagon 4.
Straight Dagon 4.
Yep.
He had a little bit of money up his sleeve.
Just a small amount. And yeah, they do have... I actually don't know when they picked that up, but I
guess...
Yapsil's
almost got his own Lincoln Sphere.
Is he really? Oh, wow, he actually does. Holy crap.
A lot of money on him. And Cinderin's working into the Ags.
He's sick of getting roared and glimpsed and shit.
Actually, that decay is going to be so bad from Medusa. Like, I know mana is normally the best way Medusa will survive, but if you start taking 10 strength with every single decay, and Illidan stands in the fights... So it's not that easy. It's not that difficult for Cinderin to go, oh, I have a single target standing and not moving at all. I guess I can decay this.
Yeah, it's going to take quite a while for him to get to that Aghanim Scepter, though.
Yeah.
He is also the sacked support on ESC, but by sacked, I mean, you know, 8k net worth.
So well, they can switch it around now as Yapsil's already finished his Lincolns.
Yeah, definitely.
So they can give a little bit more space to the Undying. How long we got before Roshan? So potentially it could be up in 5 seconds.
We'll find out how long it is on the clock in 3, 2, 1. All right, 1 minute.
Not too bad. The double damage room will then remain up for when Roshan spawns.
Yep.
The only thing is if the teams are aware of this. If ESC really feels important enough, they can just put the Lone Druid bear. Then again, it's got all the net worth of the Lone Druid. So maybe put the Lone Druid himself in the lane and buy an Aghanim Scepter.
Oh, maybe, yeah. It's probably his next item choice. He's got 4,000 gold saved up. He's already got his bear. Fully slotted.
Coming out. Actually, with the repel,
going for a play.
Pasha is currently smoked up, so he can get close. The glimpse. Oh, it goes the wrong way. Actually, puts Ira on the cliff. He saw where the glimpse ended. So Ira was stuck up there for a second, but there's no way they're going to try and fight up onto a cliff.
It's pretty funny.
Ira's actually got enough money for buyback, and he's getting a lot more cash.
Yeah, he's getting very farmed. He's catching up.
But they're giving him everything, though. Like, you look at the CS, it's 490 to him. The next one close to him is 228 on his own team. I mean, so they are giving him everything that comes their way.
We were saying 4 protect 1, so...
Yep. Now we see if this bear is capable of survive. This is what you get worried about. You put all your net worth onto a bear, which actually isn't that difficult to kill.
Yeah, it's got the evasion and it's got this, the radiance evasion if it's on the thing is on Illidan, and then also the solar crest, which makes it a bit harder to kill. And then they have the constant heals, the tether, Vlad's as well, urn charges,
but
plus soul rip.
But once Illidan gets that Monkey King bar, then that evasion from solar crest as well as from.
Yep.
Yeah, that doesn't. It's not going to help.
Yeah, slowly but surely they are acquiring a good amount of currency on the side of Fantastic Five. They look like they're going to be getting an item pretty soon on the Omni Knight and even the other Titan.
Okay. That's another good thing for Lincolns. It blocks Dagon.
Yep.
The item which may have actually cost them the bottom lane, though, because they went so defensive early on. How long can you hold on to a rapier like this? I'm wondering, too, if he just says, like, hey, I must get the Monkey King bar. If he's like, you know what, y'all are, like, it has to be a second rapier. Because if he was going to be picking up the MKB, I would have expected him to already sell this Ring of Aquila and pick up the Demon Edge. Because the courier is making his way up now. So he can actually buy... Actually, he can buy the whole thing.
Let's see what he wants.
Yeah, he can buy the whole thing now.
Yeah.
Relocate.
Hey, Yapsil's going to get it.
Woo! Nice snipe. The Observer Ward's able to reveal it, but it was just the Demon Edge. It wasn't the full shebang.
Still, super value.
Yeah, that's 3 minutes. A 3 minute window where ESC understands that there is no Monkey King bar for the Medusa, and she already used her buyback previously. So it's already on cooldown. Wait, hang on, that's not right. She didn't. Why have I got the counter? I'm looking at something else completely different. Ignore
that's
she
courier.
Never used it. It is the courier. I'm looking at the wrong fucking thing.
I was like,
I'm looking at that. I'm like, holy shit, is there a moment here? No, there's not.
I was like, when the hell did he buy out?
Elden still got the money. I had in the back of my brain that he already spent his money, so he didn't have buyback, and I connected the wrong dots. Never let me be Mr. Squiggle.
Nobody heard it.
Everybody heard it. We just amplified it. it's fine. I live with it. All right. I'll have it right at the thread. That's fine.
Nope, you asked for it. Now you won't.
Cast this game
top
for
lane.
10 years on a van.
Roar
think
on the
good
bear.
Roar. That's a lot of damage. And, well, that's all it takes to kill off a bear, but your roar is down for now. As now they slow down Keizu, Illidan. It's still good damage. Ripping into Keizu when he misses the Timber Chain, so Illidan will be able to hit a little bit longer. The slow doesn't make it easy for Keizu to walk out of here. And they manage to clean up the creep wave. Necrobooks have also been committed. Cinderin holding onto that tombstone for now, but then that split shot. Dropping Cinderin down so low they can bring down this Undying. The relocate will happen, but you burn through the Undying still. Era so low on life, and look at the damage output. He's standing his ground up against F5. Now the ET split, they want to snap him. The second he comes out of the Aegis and they've got it, he can't even turn the armor on in time. Now he will be still into the storm. They hold the line against ESC. And now you bring down the frickin'... That's it! That's it.
We've lost Toby.
We're going to IO Cam. I'm having a break.
No, that was a good fight, though, for Fantastic Five again, taking out the Aegis and everything. They didn't even have to expend any buybacks. Like we mentioned before, the Courier was taken out, so the Demon Edge wasn't on the Medusa. He has 7,000 gold on top of that Demon Edge now, too, so he's going to be able to finish his next item as well after that really shortly. And... The unfortunate thing for them there was, you know, Koikfa was, he just bought the Aghanims, so he was just sending his bear alone while his hero was farming elsewhere. And his bear goes top, it gets roared, it gets killed down. He bots his top, brings his bear back in, and then he gets glimpsed out all the way to the opposite side of the map. So they didn't have the lone druid at all for that engagement. Do we have you back, Toby?
Yeah, I'm back. He's back. I'm sorry, I just needed to tilt myself off the edge of a bridge for a moment and then just get back on my feet.
Escape you. Oh, that was good.
Not my fault. All right. My mum always said I was special.
She wasn't wrong.
All right, so F5. Hey, you know that situation I was talking about?
Which one?
You know that situation that I kept on... Wait, what? Okay, yeah. You did not just buy a Skull Basher. That was not intentional.
Yeah, that had to have been a misclick.
Well, that's when the items just automatically, like... No, that still doesn't make any sense. It doesn't work that way.
Probably just a misclick. Probably just clicked the Javelin and then was clicking... Instead of, like, left-clicking the MKB in the slot, you click the Skull Basher.
Yeah. But this is I'm seeing this movie in my mind, and I've been ripped for this in the past, so hey, rip me again. Where I'm just like, hey, they're gonna make a comeback because they've got this hero. It's always able to make some kind of massive play. And if you don't treat it with respect, you're ending up giving such a huge advantage back over. Like ESC is staring down the barrel of potentially losing a game where they had 42k net worth advantage and about 35,000 experience advantage. If they lose this, Nahaz is going to have a freaking field day with, okay, what was the biggest loss that has ever happened in Dota on an international stage? And when I say international stage, I mean like a Valve event style stage.
I think we had a 30,000 swing the other day. And then I think at Manila we had a 30,000 swing as well in the at one of the LGD games versus, I think, MVP. And then there was also like a super like ancient, the Mega Creep one for MVP. There's been a lot of crazy games like that where it's been ridiculous comebacks that we used to never see. Like the stats used to be like when you have like a 30,000 gold lead above the 30 something minute mark, it's like I want to say almost 98% chance of like winning the game. So
yeah,
breaking the stats.
But Medusa just keeps getting bigger and bigger and bigger. Like she just consumed up a Moon Shard. Hasn't dropped the Mana Style just yet. And I'm wondering if Illidan wants to. For something which may keep him alive in these fights if things do get rough. Because we haven't really seen like a huge tanky item coming up from him. Like he's 2.8k life with obviously a shield, so he's fairly tanky as it is. Is it worthwhile Illidan just saying, I'm going to stand and get the old school Satanic Rapier so I can always be alive in the fights?
Maybe a possibility. Just it's going to be at least 10, 15, like 10 more minutes until he gets the money to be able to sell it and actually purchase a full another item.
It's either that or you like you look for the damage and get through the timber. Like you get something like a Daedalus.
Yeah, like a Daedalus or something. Or maybe even another rapier at that point.
Yeah.
That might be a little bit scary, but at this point.
I'm wondering
point,
what's more efficient,
if he
like,
dies,
like
it
the Daedalus
matter.
Or the rapier.
Yeah, it might even be more efficient to just get the rapier with all the damage he has and the auras with the Elder Titan and everything too. Or with the crit, sorry. And yeah, BZZ is progressing as well. His Midas is actually super paying off in this game. He's not really able to hit creeps at all, but just being able to Midas every 100 seconds, excuse me. And now he has the Shiva's finished up already. So he's making
progression. There's a double roar, and Illidan also called out. Syndrome drops down the tombstone. Illidan will be quite happy to stand his ground and get rid of this. Solrip was already used, so say goodbye to tombstone for a minute. They move forward. Illidan lets the Mana Style go. Slows down Keizu as the man who wants to try and fight him again. Illidan, happy. Every time he gets jumped, he just turns and looks at him with that wonderful stone kind of gaze, looking for the mini bash as well on Keizu, dropping him low. The bottom lane's being pushed in by Koifa. He's actually running the Aghanim Scepter now, so the druid, the bear can be involved in the fight and then just keeps the split push going.
Did he have his bear top?
I don't know. I didn't actually see what the bear
Radiant,
was.
Radiant just blew Glyph. That actually can be a big deal. I don't know what happened if the bear was hitting.
Destroyed a tower.
So yeah, it was top. Okay.
Yeah.
So his bear was wrapping top. I was looking at the.
But you blow a gift for a tier two when like the only main thing which really matters is inside your own base.
Yeah, the Rax was getting chunked down. It got put down to almost 750 HP. So, I can understand why they did that. But
okay. Yeah. Okay.
Keizu, glimpse back, but yeah.
Not able to there's no follow up. They're still holding the line.
Keizu sold his boots, by the way, or he got rid of his boots for now. He has a blink dagger on him.
The timber. I'm already six slot of what the hell do I do now?
Yeah, he doesn't really know what else. They just bought a bunch of sentries and wards, right, for Syndarin? Yeah, Keizu bought him like 14 or 16 sentries.
Syndarin's now a charity case. I buy you as much as I possibly can. Even waiting for this Roshan, I don't know if it's really that. Okay, it's good for Koifa. It's good to have the Aegis Immortal over a lone druid, but I'm still concerned that his bear just has no effect when it gets caught out. And having a refresher orb over on the Beastmaster. Like, Pasha is holding on to his buyback for now, but he's got himself enough money where he can buy the refresher.
Yeah.
And double roars means he can refresher, roar onto the bear. They already showed they could bring it down before. You have a resummon, you think you're confident, and then you lose your second bear. You literally delete a hero in that way. And yeah, I love the way your neck just like cranks the second you see the scythe.
Yeah, Slaughter with a hex.
Maybe this is their way of stopping Illidan from attacking.
Oh, bear, top lane. He's trying to go in. He gets the Savage Roar on the Medusa. 500 HP, Rax.
There's the roar. Bear's gone. And Koifa instantly has to resummon. This was happening as F5 were being initiated on the mid lane.
I'm expecting that this game is actually going to be that Escape Gaming get Megas just because they force Fantastic Five to take an engagement and just kind of kite them around while the Lone Druid just backdoors. I feel like that's just what's going to happen in this game. But Fantastic Five does have the method to be able to deal with Megas for a bit.
I would also be very concerned if Illidan does actually go in for like that second Rapier. That just like getting Megas still isn't enough to win. You can deal with any of the creeps that come through as long as Illidan stays in base, and then you just need a quick jump from F5. He BTs out to a hero, or even I don't care if he even goes out to the Astral Spirit, anything he can go to, and then they just go straight for a GG push. And if ESC have lost that like double bears, they probably won't have enough to repel it.
Yeah.
Maybe now with the Aghanim separate from Undying, they might have a chance where they can at least make F5 weaker and they can break the high ground. But it's just a concern I've got up my in the back of my head.
Yeah, and Koikfa's just becoming to that point where you're going to almost be seeing having him 12 slots. He's got Aghanims on his hero. He's got the Diffusal 2 now placed on his hero. Bots, Midas, his bear now finishes up a full Daedalus. Completely six-slided with the Moonshard Eaton.
Yeah. As he holds the Diffusal Blade level 2.
Yeah, and Yapzor's building the Diffusal as well. They really want to just be able to get rid of that repel. And the Lincolns is actually becoming a bit of a problem.
I'm wondering if it's also their way to get around Illidan. Like, you need to burn him. If that's the way to do it. Okay, Talisman of Evasion for RMN. So, welcome to Heaven's Halberd.
Yeah, it's a good pickup. Disarm the bear for a while.
Yeah. Might even have to think about getting BKBs for the bears. Jump in, they find Illidan, his shields are up. He's got Mana Star to dodge out with the Stomp. You've already managed to get the Silence, and Illidan stands his ground. He wants to bring down the Tombstone, Soul Rib, still on cooldown for one extra second, but up on top lane. Again, this bear has its play, and again, this bear will go down. The resummon has to happen. Cinderin, don't get bashed, Cinderin. They put the Lincoln Sphere on him. The damage won't be enough. Double Sharkum's trying to keep him back too, and now the bear, Koifa, trapped inside the wall. There's your blink, Roar Refresher. They put down the Static Storm. They need to bring in Illidan for the damage, and Koifa's going to lose his life right now.
Relocate top by Yapzor.
They
he's
want the
trying
racks.
To hit the racks as a Wisp.
He's going to get Heaven's Halberd even if he tries. What, you try physical damage down with a frick of Wisp to kill off racks? Come on, you've got to be kidding me.
That was cute. I don't know if he tried to bring someone with him with the relocate, and maybe he broke the tether by accident, but...
They really want that bear again.
That was cute.
I actually love the fact the Lone Druid's dead, and you got to remember the bear will remain alive because of the Aghanim set to upgrade. So even if you do kill off Koifa, you don't really stop the Lone Druid from having an effect. The bear is actually still the hero.
Yep. Just running around farming.
Okay, so you have 6.9k gold on Illidan, and I am seeing a courier making a path up. What do we got? Okay, BZZ is about to get himself an Aghanim Scepter.
That's actually a huge deal. He doesn't even have to be near the fight now. He's going to be in no position to
it's
die.
Also,
he's
also
super tanky already, though.
It's also the buildings. ESC's like, hey, let's try and backdoor rush. Oh, shit.
Yeah, the Aghanim's hitting the buildings. They removed the healing from it, though, so it doesn't heal them up, but it does give them 10 seconds duration there.
You're still going to be very, very happy with that.
Yeah.
And the fact that he can buy it and still have enough money for buyback, like he's short by 200 right now, but he'll get that, no problem.
Yeah, he can even just sell the Midas pretty soon.
Yeah, that may actually be what he's doing because he needs to hold on to a TP scroll. Like, let's not Cloud 9 this. Never forget.
Never forget. Aegis reclaimed in 2 minutes. So that's the fourth or fifth Aegis.
How long can this go? I think I've lost that prediction. Like I moved up to 4, I think, on... Actually, do we even have the Roshan thing in this one?
No, we didn't.
That was the last one. Yeah, everything's incorrect. However, the Illidan one, well done, Fogged. We were right in that one.
Yeah.
Even if we were wrong with... Wait, first player to get 15 denies is currently none.
Nope.
Okay, that's a bug.
Nobody has 15 denies.
Yeah, no one made 15 denies, obviously.
Timber only has 13.
Oh, wow. Actually, it's true. No one has 15 denies.
Yep.
How do we have a 61-minute game with Timbersaw being the one looking at 15 denies?
It's a laning phase.
And no one's going to deny anymore. Not in this game.
No. And we actually, you know what? Yol actually got items. He's got a Glimmer and he's got a Ghost Scepter.
Not shabby. Not too shabby at all.
No. So let's take a look at what else we have. So we have the Hex that we were seeing. I mean... Yapzor has, this is the most farmed Wisp I've ever seen in my life.
Okay, Illidan. Okay, do me a favor. He's still got an extra 6.4k gold. Buy up a second Rapier and keep it back at well.
Yeah, that's probably his play soon.
Yeah. Because if you... Okay, jump, crush, Eld, and actually losing mana quickly. They are actually burning through him. But then you will have the Guardian Angel kick in. They forced off Illidan out with the ET splitter. It'll also keep ESC away from the front lines. Illidan has to go back. He needs to regen right now.
He's got to watch his positioning. That could have been a death there on him.
It's like they're trying to use him as bait, but he just underestimated how much mana they're actually burning off him. Turns on the Stone Gaze, they lock in the Timber Saw, can't go anywhere, but it's up on top lane. The bear will be brought down, but not before it brought down the melee racks, as Illidan keeps standing its ground. Another good stomp. He's got Mystic Snake available, as ESC, they're just trying to cut. Unfortunately, they can't cut through the racks with Chakram, even though that really wouldn't make a lot of sense.
They're there for show right now.
Okay, did Aegis just... Yeah, Aegis just timed out too. So that's no longer available. Keizu, that mini bash from Illidan is doing its work. They get rid of the ward, glimpse back now. They're looking to bring down Keizu. Big damage from Illidan. They relocate just in time, just far enough away. Illidan's still going to get rid of this creep wave. Cinder is now the man on the front lines. SBZZ with the Shiva's Guard jumping to the front lines, slowing down ESC. He's trying to retreat back out. Eero will get the double crush, but now with his BKB, he's in too close as well. He's dropping down. That tombstone is still up. Finally bring it down. SBZZ lives through all of this, and they're going to start the glimpse, bringing back Keizu. ESC, they have to actually get themselves out of this one. Yapsaw, no relocate available. He can tether into cheese, but that won't be enough.
He
actually tried to get it off, but it doesn't work. The shield's come up. Yapsaw.
The Raxes, though, the bear.
They have to go home. They have to go home. The top's been taken. The mid, only the range remains.
And Yapsaw actually kills BZZ. But yeah, the bear went in and took out the range Rax top, finished that out, took out the melee Rax mid, and actually finished off that tier 4 tower as well in the mid lane.
Oh, boy.
So like what I was mentioning, they're just going to... Their fights are going to take so long to be able to bring people down. Everybody's so tanky on the side of Escape that Koyf was able to just bring his bear in. He had a refresher as well there, so the Beastmaster roared one of the bears top. He resummoned. They sent the bear top. It got roared again. It got killed. Then Koyfa refreshered and brought in another bear. So they were probably... Because I was actually going to comment while you were like doing the teamfight stuff. I was like, there's no more bears. And then I click on him and I was like, oh, he's got a refresher. Okay, there's a third bear.
No, F5 weren't expecting it. And you just need a little surprise like that. They'll be there going, hey, how the hell did he get three bears out?
Yeah.
And the simple answer is going to be, well, he now has a refresher. And now they have to keep their eyes very, very close on the back lines.
Really smart itemization there by Koyfa. I love that. Like, he already knows, like, I have everything else I need. Like, that's the only thing that I could do.
This is nice, though. So Beastmaster now with the refresher orb is now going to have a double scythe.
Yeah, so four forms of lockdown.
And double waves of Necros, too. So when he goes for the initiation, he can still, like, trigger the next wave of Necros.
Yep.
Okay, Illidan, you need to buy something else. You got 14,000 gold on a Medusa. However, walking up by yourself
in
an area surrounded by four heroes of ESC,
I'm
not sure about this. It's the second rapier. Illidan, get your ass home now. This is your mother speaking.
But he sells the Manta. He picks up the second rapier. Now he's got 875 damage.
Illidan starts his TP. There's no cancel to this. However, the Aegon flies in. They jump back home again. Bears be assaulting the base.
Yep.
Another resummon up from Koyfa. He's got his refresher off cooldown in 54 seconds, so they'll have more in a bit.
Truly Defense of the Ancients.
It really is. With a small little barracks playing a supporting role. It's the only thing that stands between them and Megas.
I told you, dude. What'd I tell you, though?
Hey, you said for the first game when we actually had the bet thing for over an hour, and then F5 just crushed them. Could you also imagine if this is the way Escape don't qualify? Like, they form as no diggity. They perform so damn well in competitions leading up
top lane,
to TI.
Armin,
yep. Now Cinderin, they need a little bit of help. Where's the BTs? And the Storm going to come in, locking Cinderin down, but it's Illidan. Okay, this could be the play right now. They're going to try and go for the straight push up through mid. Fortifications available right now for Escape. You have a defense from the ET. Illidan wants to hold the line here. He still needs to attack, kill off the creep wave. And now, well,
the
do they have
stacks,
enough?
Though.
They break through the Lincoln Sphere. Illidan dropping down to half life. The bottom lane, the mid lane's pushed in. This could be the GG Megas, push. They need to find kills right now as Kazu, he is dropping low. The crush is there. The bear cannot win this game by itself, or can it? It will. Yapsil's coming in. They trigger the GA, but people need to come home. They are losing their home right now. The bear comes back up. Will it be enough? Down to 1K. They still can't beat it down. 3 euros gone. GG. The call has to come out. They want to buy back. They might be able to keep the bear off it. Yol's calling it out right now. The GG is there. The bear has actually stopped attacking in front of it. They bash it down. They bring it down. And, well, the Rax, it doesn't matter. They actually followed through with the GG. There is no Fisherman's GG this time around. 67 minutes, but F5 did not make that easy for Escape.
No, they didn't. But inevitably, we kind of started to see what was happening with that Aghanim's Lone Druid Bear, with the way the fights progressed with the Wisp and the Undying, so many different forms of healing, Timbersaw being extremely tanky, Slardar being super tanky. They're not able to get any kills quickly, and that's just what's going to happen. The team fights are going to progress to such a period where they take so long that the bear is just able to wrap around constantly, throw its life away, getting a little bit of damage each time on the buildings. And yep, they get the Raxes, they get Mega Creeps, and F5 kind of just felt like they weren't going to win the game unless they did something drastic. They go for the push, and Koikva seals the deal with his bear.
That he does. Aghanim Scepter balanced out. Upgrade for once.
Yeah.
Actually, most of the Ags are balanced. They just never get bored.
Him and Kazu, though. 849 GPM on Kazu and 916 GPM on Koikva. These two guys stood out so much in this game.
Yeah. And they still couldn't end it, though. And that's the point where you ask the question, did the laning phase work? Did the draft work? Did Escape make this so much harder for themselves? I know it's still the Medusa. We've seen this now multiple times from F5 with the way it builds to this point and then just becomes really, really hard to contest.
Yeah.
But then also F5 seem to make it difficult for themselves when they pick up an Omni Knight, a hero who, the mids are always meant to scale, right? I meant to have a big influence. There wasn't that much of an influence from BZ.
He was just a repel. It could have been a support Omni Knight, really.
Yeah, agreed. And you think what would happen if that was a different style, if that was a different hero?
Yeah, but also, it was just like Escape's laning phase was such a good idea to go for that. We even mentioned it during the draft. Like, if they go aggro Trillium, that's the only way the Undying worked. They got several kills out of it. They made it work, and it is what it is.
Yep. Game 3, we get to go to a full set, and we'll find out who will be the first team eliminated from the playoffs. Will it be Fantastic Five, or will it be Escape Gaming? We'll find out after the break.